Hello and welcome to Scientifically Explained.
Lies.
We think of lying as something we do to others, but in fact, lying also does something to us. Lying feels bad at first, but our brains soon adapt to deceiving. Since the outbreak of the deadly coronavirus, lying and the misinformation have become the favorite hobby of everyone. People are spreading misinformations and lies about coronavirus or COVID-19. As a result, those who do not research before receiving information, they not only misguide themselves, but also become a part of this lie-spreading community. For this purpose, we've made this video to talk about the top 5 lies and misinformation about COVID-19. I've invited my friend Susanna Harris to shed some light on these misunderstandings. Hi, Susanna.
Hi, everyone. My name is Susanna Harris, and I'm a microbiologist down at the University of North Carolina in Chapel Hill. And I'm here to tell you today about my top 5 lies about COVID-19. Who is lying about COVID-19? It's not actually that people are lying. I think some people might be, but generally it's more just misunderstandings and misinformation. And we have the scientists saying one thing, and then the news brings it up in a different way, and then somebody else picks it up and put their own spin on it. And by the end, we have information that's not even close to the original science. And this matters because people need to know exactly how to take care of themselves, and we all want to feel safer in what's going on. So I wanted to bring up these 5 points that I've been seeing a lot in social media and even on the news, where people are getting very confused. And all of the stuff that I'm talking about is originally posted in my own social media at Suzanne L. Harris on Instagram. But also, all of that information came directly from the CDC website. There's new science coming out all the time, but I am a big fan of only trying to communicate the stuff that we as a scientific community have come to a consensus or that we all agree on. So these are the top 5 things that I'm hearing that might not be exactly right. The first lie is that you should never touch your face. Touching your face is just fine if your hands are clean. What does that mean? Well, because I have been in my house all day, I have washed my hands several times before I eat, after I go to the bathroom, all of those different things, my hands are clean. No one in my household has been exposed, as far as we know. I live with one roommate, and he and I don't contact each other very much, and everything in my house has been cleaned. I have not touched a surface that is likely to be contaminated with the virus. However, the virus can live on surfaces anywhere from 2 to 9 days, and that's the reason that if you go out in public, even if no one else is around you and you touch some surfaces, you might want to go ahead and wash your hands right afterwards. You don't want to touch your hands to your face if you may have touched something that COVID could be on. The number 2 lie that I hear a lot is that COVID-19 is airborne. This is a tricky one because it's not technically airborne. COVID-19 is spread through droplets, and droplets can hang out in the air. Think about when somebody sneezes and you watch them from the side and you can kind of see this puff of, like, not really steam or anything, but it's little droplets and they fall to the ground. Those droplets are what COVID can transmit through. And they do stay in the air for some amount of time. Eventually, though, they fall to the ground, and that's why the surfaces get contaminated. An airborne virus doesn't need those droplets to move around. If COVID-19 was truly airborne, we would be in even more trouble. Airborne viruses are even more easily transmissible. And the reason that this matters, though, is that if you hear that COVID-19 is airborne, and then you go look up airborne virus transmission, you might be reading something that is totally not the same as the precautions you need to take for coronavirus. Now, coronavirus can be aerosolized, meaning in super tiny droplets, and those can stay in the air for up to a few hours. But this is only a problem in hospital-like settings or places where things can actually be aerosolized. You're not aerosolizing your spit and things that are coming out when you cough or sneeze. So, number 3 is you need to stay inside. You need to stay away from people as much as possible. That part is true. Oftentimes when we go outside, what we mean is we're actually going out to a grocery store, we're going out to spend time with friends, or we're going out to go to the mall or something like that. You don't want to do those things right now. If you need to get groceries, you need to get groceries, you need to get food, but try to limit the numbers of times that you need to go into the grocery store. Try to separate yourself from other people by at least 6 feet. But you do probably still need to go outside some. It's still really important for us to protect our mental health. We don't know how long this situation is going to last. And so doing things like going outside and going for a walk or getting fresh air or just seeing some sunlight can be really helpful to all of us, especially if we don't have access to a gym or other workout facilities. So if you can go for a walk and avoid people, that's okay. Number four is that masks don't do anything. So this isn't true, otherwise doctors and nurses wouldn't wear masks, right? They need to wear masks. The purpose of them wearing a mask is that they don't get sick from one person and then pass it to the next patient. They need to have the mask. The issue is that we probably don't need to. Your doctor will tell you if you need to. This is a problem because we're running out of masks, and it's really important that we keep those for the people who really need them. Masks are not effective if they're not worn correctly, if they're not put on correctly, if they're not disposed of correctly. Most people don't know that. Most people haven't been fitted for a mask. Most people don't own the N95 masks that are required to protect you from virus-sized would be tiny, but droplet-sized particles. Masks are really good at preventing the spread of disease from a sick person outwards. It's not perfect. If not worn completely tightly, they can still get out around the sides. However, if you're healthy and you get coughed on, it's still all over the rest of your face. And unless you take off that mask very carefully, you'll probably still get it towards your mouth. So leave the masks for the doctors, for the patients, for the medical workers who really need them right now. And number five is it's basically the flu. It is a different virus. We don't have nearly the same number of tools. We have a lot of different kinds of symptoms. It's respiratory, sure, but different types of coughs or different people are getting sick. Basically, it's a different situation, and we need to treat it like it is. We know some stuff from other coronaviruses. Some coronaviruses cause what we think of as the common cold, so we know a little bit of information there, but we don't yet have a vaccine. We don't yet know a lot about the treatments. We don't know about mortality rates, infectivity, a lot of these different pieces. It is a scary time in a lot of ways. We are learning a lot of things, and there are plenty of things that you can do. So don't touch your face when your hands aren't clean. COVID is spread through the air, but it's not airborne. It's spread through droplets. Stay away from people as much as possible. Make sure you get yourself some fresh air and some sunshine. Wear a mask if a doctor has told you to. And remember, this isn't the flu, but try to get the best information that you can to keep yourself and your loved ones safe. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Susanna, for answering the questions that majority of people are confused about. There is plenty of space between "we are gonna die" and "relax and forget about it." Let's try to live in that middle area, based on the facts we do have. Otherwise, anything else will put others at risk. Here, I want to share a quotation from Susanna. "Telling a story is an act of bravery and kindness. Through honesty and vulnerability, we remind others they are not alone." Is there anything I missed? What other questions do you have? Comment below, or you can follow us on social media or contact via email. Follow Susanna on Instagram and Twitter at Susanna L. Harris. And as always, thanks for watching Scientifically Explained.